Thank you guys so much for being patient, and thank you for coming, because most of the time we get two people in here and we're all kind of like looking at each other thinking we got to entertain each other. So good afternoon and welcome to Let's Talk About Sex, right? It sounds like a game show to me. Like, you know, the price is right, let's talk about sex. I don't know. There are prizes in this, however, okay? So just consider that. My name is Dena Stevens, and I am the college nurse here at Moore Park. Allison Case-Barton is our health educator, and Chad Basile is a professor in the criminal justice department. He has a laundry list of credentials, and I'll let him explain those to you. When President Sanchez named this a year of wellness, many different thoughts and ideas came into play, and we had to really break out what we thought made up the year of wellness, okay? We looked at different subjects, and over the past year, components of the health, I clearly haven't done this enough times. Over the past year, there have been numerous presentations, discussions, lectures. Anybody been to anything besides this? Yeah, what did you go to?
I went to the eating disorder
one. Okay, was it good?
It was.
Okay.
It was really
we did a lot of things. There's been everything from eating disorders to is your cell phone killing you, if you've heard that one. It was all the whole thing on mental health. They did a financial wellness one, and they've done how song and dance plays into our health. So a huge range. Did you have a question?
Yeah, do you guys post these anywhere?
They're on the portal.
Oh.
The question was, do these get posted anywhere? They're on the portal. So yeah, if you click onto the portal, it'll give you what's up for the next week, 2 weeks, how that goes, okay? So today we want to talk to you about sexual health. And when we think about sexual health, it kind of goes one way, right? Kind of look at one specific thing. I know that's what we did. But each of us has a vastly different role, not only on campus, but in this presentation. And combined, we put it all together to get a really comprehensive look at sexual health. The first part takes on a more medical perspective. I'm a registered nurse, work in the Student Health Center, I've been here 17 years, so that's my perspective. Allison is a health educator, so she's looking a little broader than I might. So she's looking specifically at how social media, particularly websites and mobile apps, are playing into this role. And then Professor Basile is gonna take another perspective of the bystander and what our responsibilities and roles are as being a bystander. Okay? So let's get started, because I want to jam through mine as fast as I possibly can. Thanks. Obviously, being a year of wellness, student health got hit and got fast, right? Because we think wellness, student health, that makes kind of sense, right? It's our mission, and the reason we are assigned to be on a college campus is that we want to keep you in class. The goal being, if we keep you healthy, if we give you quick and easy access to medical care, that you'll be more likely to attend your classes, achieve your goals that you've set for yourself here, and then move on. So basically, we want to get you in, get you to class, and get you out, right? Doesn't sound that romantic, but anyway.
But you can always come back.
You can always come back. Right. Like I said, I went here, I went off to college, worked for a few years, and now I'm back. So Chad's been here part-time for a number of years and still do different things. Allison's been in the K-12 system and joins us here. So lots of different perspectives, okay? So in the health center, we look at a multitude of topics. We're looking at everything from if you have a cold or a sore throat, the flu, maybe even a sprained ankle, to suicide, depression, anxiety, and even sexually transmitted infections in pregnancy. Okay? Clearly, on a college campus, sex comes up frequently in our office. Okay? So that's one of the reasons that I took this piece and role. You have to be able to multitask in this. I'm not very good at it. Okay. So to have a conversation about sexual health, I think we need to define it. And there's tons of different explanations, definitions of sexual health. But this one, I'm like so excited, I can barely stand myself. So let's look at what the World Health Organization, this one I chose because I think it encompasses what the three of us are about to talk about, okay? According to the World Health Organization, sexual health is defined as a state of physical, emotional, mental, and social well-being. In relationship to sexuality, it's not merely the absence of disease, dysfunction, or infirmity. Sexual health requires a positive and respectful approach to sexuality and sexual relationships, as well as the possibility of having pleasurable and safe sexual experiences free of coercion, discrimination, and violence. Okay? All right. As I started doing research for this presentation, I discovered there's so many facets of this. It's not just one piece. So what I did was kind of look at what I see in the office and what I experience with students over the years. And I kind of broke it down from there. So I started with physical because I think that's where our minds tend to go when we say the word sex, right? We tend to go to some kind of act of intimacy and relation, whether it be with a partner or maybe even if we're talking about ourselves and we're talking about maybe masturbation or something like that, right? Okay. We have to include other things, though. We've got to look at the spiritual, emotional, and psychological piece of it. And those are really intertwined. And I did put emotional and psychological together because, one, we're short on time, and today we're even shorter. And then I broke spiritual apart. So you'll kind of see. And when I'm talking about emotional and psychological, I'm talking about our feelings. I'm talking about how we react to something and what our responses are to those. So how we feel plays a huge role in what we choose to do. And what we choose to do, whether it's conscious or subconscious, can really play a role in how we feel. Okay, so you can see how those are really intertwined. Okay? Religious, we all have religious perspectives, or they don't have to be religious, they could be just spiritual. You know, and some, I guess some of you may not have any spiritual, but we have some other guiding force from the outside, whether it's something our parents taught us, or we're looking kind of at morals and values at this point, okay? And there's some very specifics set by certain religions and spiritual beliefs, right? And finally, social. Social sexual health, we're looking at things like peer pressure and social norms. And then we have to bring in social media because it's playing such a huge role in what we're doing, okay? So I'm gonna play a video for you, and it's supposed to be entertaining, so appropriately laugh. But what I want you to do when you look at this, it's a Will Ferrell video. So what I want you to do is look for things that might make up components of sexual health or things that you go, oh, that is not healthy, right? Okay, so please play, please play, please play. Of course it's not there.
Is it just taking a while to?
No, it's gone.
Hi guys. I wonder if there's internet that you could at least find it.
Yeah, I should be able to. Okay, I'm gonna go quickly and look for it just for a minute so you guys can see this. Just a break, right? You're talking for like maybe what, 5-10 minutes? You're probably already worn out, right? I know. Sorry.
And on the website, it'll look perfect because they'll cut all of this out.
We have all, thankfully, we have all these totally modern computers. And so I'm used to touch screens and all that good stuff. And
yeah, right.
This is a totally different perspective. Oh, I don't want to meet your intern. I just want YouTube. See, this is the part you guys could do in 5 seconds, right?
They've already done it.
Oh, okay, yeah. That's what I should have done, right?
Which one are you looking for?
No.
But can you sew on a button?
Yes, can you sew on a button?
That's right. Or
raise
Donna
your
sock.
Hand if you know how to sew on a button.
Oh, yeah.
And now raise your hand if you have the stuff to sew on a button. Okay, A plus.
How
a
many
plus
of you
group.
Knew you had to put a stamp on a letter to mail it? You guys are laughing, but we've had that issue. We had
a
couple people
yes.
So laughing about that. And yes. So, yes. So, see, just so you know,
email.
It's not email. Oh, come on, Will Ferrell. Where are you when I need you? I need Will Ferrell. Do you guys all have smartphones?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, so I'm going to just have you go to YouTube. Go to YouTube and pull up Will Ferrell Talks About Sex. You can imagine what my computer must look like after doing this. Allison and I are going to get thrown off campus.
So there's a little tab there that says show content.
Oh, is it doing it?
Go to the left.
Oops, sorry. I'm on the wrong one.
Is this it?
I don't know. See, I have a student helping me. I'm so happy.
Funny grandma.
Yeah, it's the funny grandma one.
Swedish people.
Just do the, it's like 3 minutes long. It's a pretty quick one. But I want you to think about what's in there. I can hear it.
Oh, there we go. No. Oh.
So can I go from this? Did I? Oh.
Not the red eggs.
Clearly, yes.
So is the grandma one?
It's the grandma one. It's, yeah.
So can we do show content at the bottom?
Yes.
Is that what you're talking about?
Okay, no more Xing out of things. Okay, see? See, I learned something about computers today.
And hit show content
again. I'm showing so much content, I don't know what to do. It's freaking me out. Although now they don't really need it because they've all seen it.
Trouble is that antivirus is flashing. I don't know what that's doing.
Oh my word.
It just says try again later, so we won't worry about that. We'll just let them finish it. Sounds like a nightmare.
Since they're watching here. See that flashing antivirus thing?
Yeah.
Click on that and turn that off because that's just killing me. That's killing me.
Okay, feel better now?
Get rid of that job is available. Kill that too.
But once I get back to the PowerPoint, it'll go away.
Because that's just killing me.
Well, that is embedded, believe it or not.
The link is embedded, but
right.
The movie is
the movie itself. You
so it's
just
looking
see.
For the movie that can't find.
Got it. Okay.
So I actually have
the videos. And it's like commercials like that embedded into my
So when you guys do the
got it.
Presentate when you do the video that you post, can we send you these videos that you
perfect.
Could?
No problem.
We'll do that. We'll actually send you our PowerPoints and then you'll have them. Yeah. If you have a card or if you could just put your information down. Svetlana, got it. Okay.
Everybody kind of get through this? Nobody's laughing though.
There was laughing.
Oh, okay.
There was laughing.
It is funny. It's very funny, yes. Now this little old lady that is talking to Will Ferrell, she's like communicating between him and his girlfriend, and she keeps walking across the street saying like really dirty things. It's really a cute video. I'll have to go see the movie now. Okay, I hear the ending music, right? I can hear it. Okay, let's cut it off so I can finish so you guys can get on to the next thing and get out of here on time. Okay, so what things do you think you saw in there that would make up sexual health or unhealth, if you want? Look at some of this, the past. What's physical in there? What do they talk about in physicality? Physical sex. What pieces do you see or hear? Yeah.
They're married and they're still wanting to have sex.
Yeah. Anybody else? She actually walks across the street and kisses him, right? So, and she's pregnant. So, a lot of pieces there, right? Okay. Spiritual, maybe? I don't know. That one's a little far-reaching. Emotional and psychological, definitely, right? You can see the pieces that they're kind of pulling out in the things they say and how she feels about him and how he feels about her and the breakup and all that kind of stuff. And then there's a quick snippet about, with Tina Fey, about restraining orders. So, that's a whole other component. So, you can see that a three and a half minute clip has huge impact, and we're not even aware of it, right? You'd be sitting in classroom or in the movie theater seeing that 3 minutes, and sexual health never entered your mind, right? Those are kind of normal social norms, right? Okay. I think for poor Mama Ramos in this thing, she's like, oh, I can't do this anymore. Okay. So I'm sure there's a ton more in that we could dissect, but I'm going to go as quick as I can. Okay. So when we talk about sex, oops, am I doing? Yep, I'm doing good. Okay. Most of us associate sex with positive things, right? That it feels good. It's the good stuff, right? But we have to look at both sides. We have to look at the violence that's involved in sex, the coercion, the drugs and alcohol. Okay, I want you to keep those things in mind. And how do we learn to protect ourselves and stay healthy in a sexual way without going, you know, doing things and being abstinence for the rest of our lives, right? I don't want you living in a closet. Okay. Masters and Johnson looked at sexual health, especially physical sexual health, into four phases. They looked at okay. Excitement, plateau, orgasm, and resolution, right? Those are pretty straightforward, right? But those are very physical things, things we feel. Okay? So, let's look at this. Things to just kind of, words we think about, things we talk about when we're thinking about sex, right? Pretty much things you could probably think about. Maybe these, maybe not as much, right? Or tend to go this way, not this way. Okay, so look at this sexual exposure chart, okay? I want you to think in your heads, I don't need numbers out loud, how many partners you've had in your life. And then look at the corresponding number across. Okay, so one partner with one partner gives you one exposure. Okay, that works for us, right? But let's get on the real world, right? Most of us have more than one partner, okay? And you can see how simply this number goes up exponentially all over the place. And 12 partners, yeah, that's a pretty large, but look at the number of exposures that creates. It's astronomical. So theoretically, you could have a sexually transmitted infection, a disease that could change your life, that could even end your life, and you've never even directly had sex with them. That's a pretty complicated thought, right? So then you can't look at like sex and not think about pregnancy. So at the heat of the moment, we're not thinking about that, right? We're just, doesn't matter how great intentions we have, and I know what you guys are doing out there because I hear it every day, okay? I know where it's being done, where it's not being done, it's in the closet, it's under the bed, I get it, okay? But we're not thinking about sex in that, or contraception in that moment. But if we look at all these, and this side tells you if you use it perfectly, letter by letter, this is what's probably gonna be, these are the statistics. For typical use, this means how most people are using it. These are the results. So you can see they're pretty different, especially as we go down, okay? You know, injectables, great, but if you don't do it on time, your numbers go up huge, right? But there's 15 methods on this, including no method, okay? But only two of them prevent STDs. Okay, so there's a whole nother gamut, is that you might be using the birth control pill, all fine and dandy, but you can still get an STD from someone you haven't even slept with. So you see how that all kind of plays into it. And those definitely play into our physical sexual health. If we've got a rash, if we've got bumps, we've got discharge, anything like that can make a huge impact. Okay? Okay, I just have to throw in a quick laugh because you haven't laughed in 5 seconds. So I like this one. This is my favorite. I must have gotten it from the internet. You'd be amazed what people think they can get from the internet. I read it on the internet, so it must be true, right? Like that commercial, whatever insurance commercial that is, okay? But just some kind of things to laugh at. So what do we do to keep physically sexually healthy, okay? Pretty common sense stuff. Do the things we'd keep to stay healthy without sex, right? Eat well, exercise, drink plenty of fluids, get fruits and vegetables, those kind of things, right? But when we're looking at sex, limit your number of partners, and now you can really see why, right? Always use a condom. Get tested at least once a year. And depending on your sexual behaviors, that number can change and go up, okay? Research your birth control options. Know what's available to you. And that doesn't mean, you know, I've got birth control, I don't need a condom. Not true. And girls, we're not off the hook. There are female condoms out there. So no guy should ever be able to tell you, I'm too big, I can't wear it. It doesn't exist, okay? Know who you're sleeping with. Respect yourself, right? If you respect yourself, you're less likely to do something that maybe you wouldn't do, okay? Get vaccinated. Some STDs are vaccine preventable. Okay, two of them. Use your smartphone. Okay, does that mean surf the Will Ferrell video I just said? No. Talking about two things. Number one, handy dandy flashlight, right? You're in the back of a car, it's totally dark, you're under the blankets because it's freezing cold outside, and you decide to have sex for the first time. Can you see? No. Okay, unless some of you have x-ray vision, which I do not have. Okay, so you can't see. Well, if you can't see it, how do you know what's there? So the likelihood of you coming in contact with something without looking is higher, right? And this happens, I hear this story, unfortunately, all the time. So what I'm saying is, pull out that handy dandy flashlight app, flip it on, take a quick peek, and move on, okay? The other piece that I love smartphones for, and I do not believe there is an app for this, keeping track of who you've slept with. I don't necessarily mean you need a little black book or night, days, times, positions. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is a name, preferably first and last, and some way to contact this person. Because I hear that, oh, I hooked up over this weekend with this great guy, and I, you know, where were you? Oh, I was in Irvine. Where? Well, I think at a frat house. I can't really remember because I was drinking. Okay, well, you have an STD. Chances are you got it somewhere or you gave it to somebody. Well, when we don't know who it is, how do we ever warn somebody else, right? So that's how I think Allison's going to go through a whole thing on your smartphone in a minute, okay? So what about emotional, psychological, and sexual health? Okay? The two intertwine, like I said earlier. We have to look at how we feel, how we respond, our emotions, and how those impact how we act. Okay? And when we're adding alcohol or drugs to it, our emotions might not be the same, right? Things we do under the influence are very different than things we might do when we're sober. Okay? So, too often what happens, and I hear too frequently, is that somebody went against those deep-seated thoughts and feelings, and then they end up upset. And that makes a huge impact on physical sex. If you are feeling regret, if you are feeling embarrassment, if you are feeling fear, then you're certainly going to have a different perspective on a healthy sexual relationship. Okay? Okay, some tips. Okay, these are common sense again, right? Nothing new, nothing too exciting. Have a good support system. Get help, right? We talked about you can get help here on campus, right? 6 sessions, awesome, okay? So definitely something you can do, okay? Spiritual, we're looking at morals, values, religious beliefs. There's tons of things. I'm sure you guys have heard them, whether you heard them from your parents, from church, from a classroom. Don't have sex before marriage, birth control is bad, you know, you should reproduce, all those things. Sex only exists between one man and one woman, not one man and 7 women, or not 2 men, okay? So lots of different things come into play. But this is where you have to look at where you really stand. We're adults. We need to start to look at those decisions and how they're going to affect our sexual relationships, okay? All right. Tips. Right? More genius tips, right? These are common sense, just like most of this is, okay? Is be cognitive, be aware, okay? Just like everything. If you're not thinking about it, chances are you're gonna ignore it and move on. Understand how they affect it. How is my agreement with myself of purity until sex gonna be impacted if I go out on this date with someone I'm not really sure of, okay? Trust somebody that you can talk to, spiritual advisor, a priest, a rabbi, somebody that you feel safe with. I'm not encouraging you necessarily to go and spill your guts to someone you're not sure of. That's definitely not what it is, okay? And have faith in your beliefs. It's okay to have those beliefs, and it's okay to stand by them, okay? Okay, so we're gonna get on to social sexual health. Whoops, uh-oh, where did it go? Okay, good. Okay, so things like peer pressure, social norms, drugs, friends with benefits, things like that, okay? Because these are definitely playing a role, okay? People tend to think there are gaps between their behavior and normal behavior, okay? Usually overestimating the relationship of alcohol use, drug use, and sexual experience. And what interestingly was found by this Dr. Katrina Pereira from USC is that people tend to adapt their behaviors to fit what they think is a perceived norm. So what I'm saying, and this is generally men more than women, but it happens on both sides, is that if I think that somebody is having more sex than I am and they're not using birth control, they're not using a condom, then I'm going to change my behaviors to fit that social norm. So I fit into that social norm. So you can see where that would be quite dangerous, right? You know, if I think that one or two partners is acceptable, but I think the world is having 15, you can see how my behaviors would change drastically and put me at a different risk. Okay? All right, so before I wrap this up, there is laws that are gone into effect and you need to be aware of them, especially at this age, because lots of things go on and a lot of them affect us here on the college campus, okay? There are restrictions that and requirements of reporting of things that go on college campus, things like specifically crimes, even if it's something like somebody stole your laptop. Okay, there's reporting requirements, and this covers lots of different things, okay? Basically, a majority of these laws fall under what they call Title IX, and Title IX was originally created to make equivalency in women's sports and men's sports, okay? That was back in 1976. We've come a long way since then, right? So the laws have started to evolve to match much more of what we're dealing with in today's society, okay? The Cleary Act, or was created for Jean Cleary, who was a 19-year-old college student at Lehigh University, and she was raped and murdered in her dorm room on campus. And what happened was her parents got upset, needless to say, right? And they caused a huge uproar, and they went to bat and started to talk about they weren't informed of how much criminal activity was going on campus. So that's when the Cleary Act came into act, and that actually came in 1990, sir. She was a student in 1986, okay? So that went into that. Okay, so now we're looking at, that's where the really big crime things went in. You have to report crime, and it doesn't just include your campus, it has to include the surrounding area. For us here, we don't have dorms, right? But a lot of four-year universities, and there are actually two-year universities or colleges that have dorms. It has to include those housing pieces if they're owned by the university or the college, okay? So that encompassed all that. But still, that wasn't enough, right? Times evolve again, things change, and we end up with a lot more issues with sexual problems, right? Rape, domestic violence, assault, things like that, okay? So the second one that went into effect was called VAWA, or Violence Against Women's Act. And this one much more narrowed this down and looked far more at the sexual component of it. And it was designed to create programs to prevent things from happening before they happen. So universities and colleges are required to put into place prevention programs. Okay, and that's relatively how that's all coming in, and how it's changing is changing like almost by the minute. Okay, so it's coming, and it may change shortly as things progress. Okay, the second one that went into act was the SAVE Act. Okay, and this one looked at colleges and their students and employees, which was another different piece. Right, so now, and it's looking specifically at sexual violence. Okay, so a lot of things that fall under Title IX, but have their own kind of component to them and are demanded by the colleges. And we can be fined, or any university can be fined, $35,000 per incident that we don't report or we don't report correctly. Well, you can imagine, you know what? Tuition has to go up to cover that $35,000, right? I don't know about you. The other thing they can do is pull our financial aid capability. So if anybody in here is on financial aid, your tuition went up and you can't get financial aid. Are you going to go to that school? Probably not. So it's a huge issue and we really have to address it. So back in September of 2014, Governor Jerry Brown signed into law the Bill 968. Okay? And basically what this is the yes means yes law. And this is a change, because no was no, but it was too vague. And in terms of prosecution and the issues in courts and things like that, it was too vague. So they went to a yes means yes law, okay? And what does that mean? Oops, okay, I'm going to have you guys do a real quick one, and then we're going to be done. Okay. Yes. Yes means yes, and according to the bill, lack of protest or resistance does not constitute consent, nor does silence. Affirmative consent must be given throughout a sexual encounter and can be revoked at any time. Okay, so somebody may say yes to sex and then change their mind, right? So one more quick video and I'm out of here, okay? I want you to go to YouTube one more time. And what do you think
so
that one's under?
T consent.
T-E-A, like the kind you drink. Consent. It's very cute.
Is everybody close to somebody else who has a smartphone?
Yeah, if you guys move around.
Does anybody want to?
I can pull mine up.
I can pull mine up too.
Did you find it?
If you're still struggling with consent,
that's
okay.
It.
Even just hearing it is really good.
It's like a video nightmare, huh?
Like, it's like a computer nightmare.
No, it is.
I'm just going to announce it and then I'll be done. Did you guys, were you guys able to see it? Do you have it? Yeah.
Or you didn't hear it. You can hear it though.
Oh, you've seen it. Okay. It's a good video. Have you ever seen that video? It's a really good video. I know, isn't it funny? I know.
Isn't that so funny?
I know, I love it. Okay, everybody's made tea. Okay, it's a nice way to explain it, right? So anyway, that's what I want you to think about and know that only yes means yes. And at any point, if they become unable to give consent, the answer is no, and you have to back off, okay? Because they're much, this is gonna be a much more forward thinking in order to prosecute this, okay? Okay, so Allison is gonna take over and she's gonna talk to you about websites and mobile apps.
Right, so, thank you. This is a huge, huge part, especially of college age dating and college age life now, as we'll soon see. And I did a lot of research about this because I have not ever been a mobile dating app user. I've been married a really long time, and I just don't date anymore, except with my husband, who's so sweet, right? So I did a little research because I love to do that, and I found that these are the most commonly cited mobile dating apps on. Every magazine seems to do top 10 dating apps, top 8 dating apps. Anyway, these ones always keep popping up, and I'm sure that many of you recognize these. That's good. As you can see, even though they're maybe the best mobile dating apps, they are not the most used mobile dating apps, and we'll see that in a second. So I thought this was kind of swell. I went to the Verizon website, and they have actually a history. They have this really cool little timeline of a history of digital dating. And I did not realize it, but it has its earliest roots in 1965. I mean, maybe some of your parents weren't even born in 1965. I don't even want to talk about it. I kind of remember people talking about computer dating like it was a new and exciting thing. Do you remember, Chad, computer? Like people talking about computer. That's so funny. Anyway, so it was developed by, so in 1965, the earliest one, it was developed by Harvard undergrads. And they developed this scientific questionnaire, and it cost $3. And students could buy the questionnaire and fill it out, and then mail it back in with a stamp in a mailbox. Because that's how you had to do it then. And then they would come up with a scientifically accurate romantic pairing. Not so different from today's mobile dating apps, actually, just a lot slower, right? So these are the top mobile dating websites or apps now. And I thought mobile dating apps were different from websites, but it turns out that it's a pretty gray area, and a lot of things like Match.com and eHarmony.com that used to be just websites, like you had to use your big old computer, right? Now they have apps as well, just to compete with the rest of the online apps. So it's also interesting to note that Match.com is actually part of the Match Group, and it's owned by Interactive Corp, and it's part of, so other apps are part of that group too. You'll maybe be surprised to know that Plenty of Fish, OkCupid, Black People Meet, Our Time, which is for over 50 people, and Tinder. I did not know that Tinder and Matt was part of the Match Group, so today I learned, right? Well, the other day I learned, actually. So, very interesting. According to a 2013 Statista survey of U.S. adults, we as a culture in the U.S. have made a big shift in thinking about online dating. So a majority of Americans now consider online dating a great way to meet people. They think it's completely acceptable. They know people who have met that way. Don't you love it? I know people who met that way. Sounds kind of, I don't know, sinister. Previously had viewed online dating negatively, and also think it's easier to ask someone out online than in person. We were talking about that a little bit earlier today. Interestingly, only about half of men and women polled thought that online dating was safer than meeting in a bar. Now, I don't know about y'all, but when I was in college, that was not considered a super safe way to meet people in a bar, right? So that's a really interesting observation by the survey. All righty. So, here we go. Okay. So in the U.S., the rate of online dating has grown overall from 11 to 15% of the dating public, right? From 2013 to 2015, according to this study by the Pew Research Center, the rate in the, but look at the college age rate. Look at you guys. You've tripled. It's tripled for you. I mean, that's pretty astounding growth over 2 years. Amazing. I was telling Dena earlier, I think it's so funny, the little 65 plus category has stayed exactly the same. So I'm imagining my dad, who's actually he's turning 80 this year, is sitting there trying to figure out how to do a profile, and it makes me laugh out loud, actually, to think of that. Anyway, so other interesting data from this survey, stigma is reduced. We saw that on the previous slide. One-third, this is interesting, one-third of the people using these sites never actually went out with anybody that they met on the sites, but 66% have, so two-thirds have, and that's up from 43% 2 years before. So that's gone up a lot. One in five online daters ask for help in developing their profiles. I have to say I helped my best friend with her profile, so I can kind of get that. I'm validating that finding myself. And about 1 in 10 adult Americans have used online services, and about 5% are in a marriage or a committed relationship with somebody that they met online. So another little interesting fact. Okay, so there are possibly advantages to online dating and online hooking up, I guess. So if you consider dating to be like finding a needle in a haystack, you can imagine that mobile dating apps or online apps could take away some of the hay, make it easier to find that needle, right? A common theme is that using dating apps is emotionally safer than in-person date finding, right? That you don't have to risk being rejected, at least in person, with the person looking at you and sitting right next to you. And according to one 2010 study of men who have sex with men, online dating apps, especially to so-called gay sites, have made dating far easier for this segment of the population, too. Are there any other advantages that you can think of? Has anybody ever considered it or thought about any other advantages? Okay. So there are some disadvantages. So let's talk about those a little bit. So today's college age adults have made dating and hooking up easier, but should it be easier, right? So surviving awkward mistakes that the rest of us had to survive, reading body language and involving other senses in your choice of long or short-term mates is part of gaining social skills. So I have concerns. We were just talking about that before we got started, about the loss of social skills. I don't know if that's the case or not. I suspect it is. And also, what do you actually know about the person that you're hooking up with, right? All you know about is what they decide to put on their profile. So in researching for this presentation, I read several anecdotes about people using other people's photos, lying about themselves, and so on. And even if they do use their own pictures, can you judge a book by its cover, right? This is sort of a funny aside as I was wading through all this information, and that was that according to the Privacy Rights Clearinghouse, the average male dating app user is taller than the average U.S. adult male. And the average female app user weighs less than the average U.S. female, right? So, I think there might be a little fibbing going on there. I thought that was really funny. Okay, so privacy concerns are considerable. You enter all kinds of sensitive personal data, including, in some cases, your current location, right? Again, according to the Privacy Rights Clearinghouse, any information you give is permanently on the internet after about 20 minutes, which I did not know and is true, I guess. Many of these companies harvest your information and sell it to other companies. They say the data are anonymized, but that's actually really, really difficult to do. And companies are not willing to give your data back to you without a court order. So if you put something on there and you want to suck it back, you need to get a court order to do that. That's pretty intense, right? And finally, the online dating industry is unregulated, completely unregulated, in fact. And its claims of using science to find your true match are far-fetched at best and perhaps fraudulent at worst. Okay, I could go on, but I won't. Suffice to say that there are significant privacy concerns. There's also the matter of increased sex partners, especially for the 66% who are using and dating the person that they found on these apps, right? So between dating apps and a very open-minded view of friends with benefits, college-age students are likely to have over 8 sex partners by the time they turn 24, right? So also interestingly, in a couple of studies, one of college students and one of men who have sex with men, both studies reveal that the use of social media in general, in particular Facebook, has a positive correlation with increased sex partners compared to non-users of Facebook, right? In the males who have sex with other males study, the average number, I'm trying not to be shocked here, but the average number of partners, sex partners in the past 3 months for this group is 3. So now we're not talking about 6 years and 8 partners. We're talking about 3 months and 4 partners. So that's a lot of sex partners, a lot of different sex partners. So going back to Dena's slide, let's draw our attention to 8, and notice how many contacts we then have. 255 contacts for that the average college age student. So I'm just letting that sit in your brain for a moment, okay? So this group is probably the best informed about pregnancy prevention and STI prevention, probably because you learned about it on the internet, right? But you still want to have sex, and you want to have it a lot as a group, right? The solution many have chosen is to have oral sex only, at least on the first date. So that's the salute, right? No, I know. Thank you for looking shocked. I'm just like, wow, that, you know, huh? Okay, I'm very old. That's all I can. This made me feel very old. All right. So here's the deal about that, though. So as a result, there's been a significant increase in oral herpes in human papillomavirus cases, and it correlates exactly with the growth of mobile dating app use. Now I have your attention. In fact, according to the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta, oral sex, I want everybody to like put your phone down and look at my face right now. Check it out. According to the CDC, now the most common cause of mouth and throat cancer, 72% of mouth and throat cancer is caused by oral sex. Ah! Used to be tobacco and alcohol, and you'd be like, no, now we have to add a whole, I mean, this is huge, right? And interestingly, so men.
Does that mean we should start smoking again?
No, no, because if you're having oral sex and drinking and smoking, you exponentially increase the likelihood that you're gonna have mouth and throat cancer. So here's the deal, men twice as much as females, and across all ethnicities. So it's not like, oh, it's mainly white people, or it's no, it's even across all ethnicities. So everybody had the same bright idea. Thank you for chuckling, I appreciate that. Like the pity chuckle, that's so funny. Okay, so what are some solutions? Right, well, we're not likely to stop the practice, hard as we might try. As I said, the current college-age population, it has a very open-minded view of sex/casual sex. With the use of condoms or dental dams, the possibility of spreading herpes and HPV, but without the use of those, the likelihood and possibility of spreading herpes and HPV is real. Question. Yeah.
What's a dental dam?
It's a little piece of plastic. I don't know if we have dental dams at the Student Health Center, but you could use Saran Wrap. Saran Wrap.
Dollar store
has dental dams?
No, they have Saran Wrap.
Oh, Saran. Oh, well, Vons has Saran Wrap. You can get it any. Your mom has Saran Wrap. Just go get some from her. So, anywho. Oh, see you guys later.
Bye.
Sure. So important is this emerging health problem that national health organizations are really working on the best outreach method. One that shows a lot of promise is actually having pop-up ads telling people about perhaps where they could get dental dams or saran wrap, or to use condoms if they're going to have any sex, but particularly if they're planning to have oral sex. This is a thing, you guys. It's a big deal. Another great idea I found was in the form of another app called Sex Positive. I thought this was super cool. So this was developed by the University of Oregon Student Health Services, and it's a free app. And it allows users to determine quickly for themselves different types of sexual contact, their relative risks, safer sex practices in communication and advice. You could download it right now on your phone. I will wait. It is a fantastic. No, I'm serious. Go to your app store right now and get it. It's free.
I don't want my mom to see that.
You know what, guys? You're grown up. We're practicing. Right. This is a really big deal. Yeah. It's kind of cool. Dena and I were sort of playing with it in my office. This thing spins around, and you can. So this one is mouth and vagina, but you get like toe and food, and I mean it's like hilarious. It's hilarious, but it has really great, very good advice on how to stay safe. And while you are at it, if you would like, you could also download Student Health 101, which is the student health magazine that is free for students on campus here, because we bought it for you, which is where I found Sex Positive. Right? They have really great articles to talk about sexual health, multiple articles, and violence against women articles every single month. And it's a great source of health information for students. Health-related things, too, like how to travel safely, how to get a job, how to dress for your job interview, those kind of things, too. So all that to say, very easy to get on your phone right now. Oh wait, 5 more seconds. You guys are way
faster.
You guys are done. You guys are done, right? You guys are done. If you need help with that, like the number again, I'll get it for you. So we've talked a lot about media aspects of sexual health. We've talked a lot about physical, emotional, all those kinds of things. And now we're going to talk more about a societal view of sexual health. And to help us with that in the last 15 minutes is...
Or 10 minutes.
I'm so sorry. I talked
Sorry.
Way too
well,
long.
So is
Chad. So thank you so much.
Okay, wonderful. Well, I...
Do you need that?
I have... I need to load this first.
Okay.
So if I can...
Oh, so you know what? We could go back to the... Oh, okay.
Well, what do you think bystander really means when we talk about a bystander while I'm doing this? Who has an idea? Has anybody been to any bystander training? No? Yes? No, can I make this work? Let's see. Maybe.
You could put us all to shame, Chad.
Oh, I wouldn't bet on that. Okay, so here we go. Oh, there it is. Takes a while to load, though, right?
Just depends on who you are, I guess.
Yeah, there we go. Not bad.
You have an old computer.
Yeah,
exactly.
Well,
you have to hold the mic.
Oh, I need the mic. Okay, look there. I like to see them wave frantically, though. That looks pretty fun. Okay. Well, I don't like mics, but just because they're so nice, I'll carry this around. So when we talk about bystanders, I think the easy definition of the word is what? Just somebody hanging around, right? So I think a lot of people will think about
50
years. We won't have a chance to look at that. So, you know, what are some common scenarios when you're a bystander? I brought it up early. Those here who were here early, I brought up, hey, we were struggling with this, and nobody helped us. You all just sat there and watched. Why is that? For those who are remaining, why did you just sit there and watch us struggle, cry? I thought Dena was really upset. I was not too upset because I can talk about anything for an hour with no PowerPoint. I kind of think our lives are kind of now death by PowerPoint. Kind of that. And it's slow. Yeah. So really, really, you know, when you're looking, when you're having a lecture, don't you really want a connection, right? And it's kind of hard to connect through a PowerPoint. I think we're just kind of all staring at the PowerPoint, you know, especially when the speaker does this. I love that. So being a bystander is about connections. It's really about connections. You're here in the room and someone's having difficulty, but you know, we're kind of trained to stay out of people's business. Who's been told, mind your own business? Yeah, I get that. Somebody's gonna tell me that right now, I think, right? Okay, so this idea of minding your own business, what does that mean to you, mind your own business? What do you think? There's no wrong answer. When I ask, what does that mean to you, you can't be wrong, right?
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, just stick to your own business, right? Right? Yeah, but is that always a good idea? So we'll have to skip a bit. Sorry. You know, would you stop a child abduction? I have a little movie, and I have to skip a bit because I now have 7 minutes. But look, you see somebody like me grab a kid, and the kid's struggling. Who's been to the grocery store and seen a bratty kid? Yeah, it was probably me, except, you know, you weren't there when I was a little kid. I was a difficult child, I'll admit it. And what do? You're in a grocery store. You see a mother slap the kid. What are you going to do? Be honest.
Nothing.
Now you see blood. Mother slaps the kid and there's blood. Part of her 18 karat diamond ring cuts the kid across the face. Now what are you gonna do? Yeah.
You would like confront them to so it doesn't end up becoming a worse problem inside the room?
Yeah, so confront them. Hey, what the heck are you doing?
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting because the three of us are really first responders. Everybody knows what that means, a first responder? A nurse is a first responder. They're trained in their education and maybe part of their personality. They're trained. I'm a former FBI agent. I was an FBI agent for 24 years. I'm also an attorney, sorry. I'm a recovering attorney. And I've taught here for 5 years, and I'm a new full-time professor. But even your professors, to some degree, but certainly nurses, certainly former law enforcement, are first responders. And the only difference between a first responder and you is the training. That's it. You could all be first responders if you're so inclined, and you get the training. Part of the personality, though, some people are first responders, and I hope that everybody that I'm sharing a little time here today becomes more of a first responder. That was my little objection. Okay, now I kind of want you to watch this. This is pretty awful. This occurred in China, and we have a van coming up, and this is a little toddler. She's a little over two. This is kind of hard to watch, so I'm sorry, but it really makes the point. And you know, she's just a typical little two-year-old. They don't know what's going on. And she gets hit. And so there she is. Now he hasn't run over her yet. He runs over her with the back tires now. Okay, it gets worse. It gets worse. Yeah, if you don't like this, just don't look at it. It's okay, you don't have to look at it. So this just adorable doll is there, you know. And I don't have time for you to see the whole movie, but it goes on and on. Eventually, okay, now if you don't like things, look away. Just look away because the poor thing gets run over again.
Gosh. Did he see her?
It's unclear.
He did.
Now she's kind of conscious. She's getting conscious. Somebody kind of stops. Now this is the one that really sort of is difficult. Even a mom walks by. finally, this woman comes by and she says, "What's going on?" And it looks to me like she's calling around saying, "Hey, whose little adorable girl is this?" And she at least now picks up the girl, not really in the way I would, but she at least removes the poor girl, and this sadly is the mother.
Oh my God.
So the mother arrives now, and of course she's, you know, gonna be completely, it just turns out, I thought this was really a dramatic example. This happened a few years ago. And so, you know, you've gotta wonder, I mean, for me, I'm a parent. Who else is a parent? You guys are little young, so we got at least one parent. I know maybe some others. For me as a parent to see this is excruciating. And every time I viewed that video, it doesn't get any better for me. I got to tell you, maybe it actually gets worse. And I apologize, you know, to anybody, but I mean, look at these people are just walking by.
That's shocking. I mean.
It is shocking, isn't it? I think it's reprehensible. You can go on the internet, as I did for many years now, and you can find, I first found this about 4 years ago, this video, and I, yes, sir?
Do you think that would happen in America?
I don't know, but I've seen things like that firsthand as a first responder, and perhaps our my colleagues here have as well. There's a lot of reasons for this. It's a somewhat well-known sort of human trait or human behavior trait called this bystander effect. And here's how it goes, basically. The more people watching, the less likely someone is to give aid. The more people watching, the more people in a group seeing something like this. So you're more likely to get aid if there's fewer people around, which makes no sense whatsoever, right? Because you would think, hey, if there's more people around, we're gonna feel safer giving aid, and there's more people that we can consult. But strangely, at least the literature and studies, and there's been a lot of studies about this, and you can go on the internet and see all sorts of really interesting experiments that people on crutches that fall down, and people just kind of, you know, walk by like this and sort of are annoyed, you know. Oh, look at that person's in pain, I'm annoyed. Not let me help them. So what I've seen is this. First responders see something like this that take over the scene. I had something happen years ago on 118 myself. There was a crane of all things, a huge crane, which flipped over and ejected the driver about 100 feet into the roadway. I was about maybe 10 cars behind just by thing. And of course, I stopped my vehicle. I got out. I put up flares. Nobody else did. They just went around.
Because most people assume that someone else is
going to
do it.
Maybe, yeah, maybe. I also think it's training, though. I think without putting any, I think it's, I said it's reprehensible, but I don't know these people, and I think it is because of my training. I think I'm trained to get involved in things. All right, these ladies are trained to get involved in things. When you're not, you're sort of thinking, there's no trigger. We have triggers. We've been trained with triggers. We see blood, we see whatever we see, we react, we know what to do. Most people don't. And so most people just say, well, somebody will come along. What I'm hoping is, I know this is a small audience, but you know, it's okay. What I'm hoping is, if you see someone in distress, right, do something, at least call. Make a 911 call. You don't really have to get involved, right? You just use your phone, everybody knows how to do that. Or make some noise, or tell somebody else to call and do something. So you don't have to worry about liability. I told you I'm an attorney, licensed to practice in the state of California. There is a Good Samaritan law, and the Good Samaritan law says basically this. If you're in good faith, not being paid, right, you give some kind of medical or non-medical care at the scene, you're not gonna be liable from anything you do or you fail to do. Okay, so long as you're not being paid, they're in good faith, and you're acting reasonable, right? Now, if you're gonna stop the bleeding by severing the head, you know, probably not a good idea. You know, all bleeding stops eventually, right, ladies?
Yes.
All bleeding stops
yes.
eventually.
When it's
okay.
All one way or the other.
Yeah, one way. Yeah. If you stop living, the bleeding stops, right? But look, if you give, you know, just usual eight, whatever you can do. You know, just stand there and attract attention. Maybe a nurse will come along, all right? So anyway, you have the protection of the law. This was kind of cute. I'll show you this one if it'll play. This was in Sweden, and what they did was they put a little kid on a park bench, and it's really cold. In Sweden, it gets cold, so they're probably around zero or less here. And anybody speak Swedish? No? Okay. And so he just sits there until people come along. And he sort of is cute, you know. And this basically says there's a hidden camera that's watching Johannes. And so he kind of acts pathetic. And you know, his little story is, if anybody asks him, he says basically, I forgot, I lost my jacket at school, and my mom's coming to bring me a new one. But she's, it has been a while. So who thinks this is kind of an emergency? Maybe eventually, right? Depending on how cold it is. And he's really cold. He's a good actor.
Yeah.
And various people come along. And so sadly, we don't have much time, so I have to kind of make it stop. So look, some people come along, and eventually one guy actually takes off his coat, and all he's got on is like a little t-shirt. And he's a young guy, maybe about 19 or 20, and it's just adorable. And he's sitting there, and he's talking to a little Johannes and giving him his coat. So this is another example. Sometimes it maybe is simple things. Okay, this is an example of bystander interaction. So, you know, part of this is, I really like this quote from Einstein, you know, our task must be to free ourselves, by widening our circle of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature and its beauty. And this comes from the guy who pretty much single-handedly invented the atom bomb, right? So in later in life, I mean, his theories led to the eventual creation of the atom bomb. And you know, what should I do? Well, with that just adorable little girl right in China, a bunch of people did nothing. You know, at least am I a witness? Should I take a picture of it? To me, at least, filming it is better than nothing, right? How about call for help? Here's what I'd like you to think about. Make a connection. Have some compassion. I am interested, but I'm not nosy. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Don't say being interested is kind of being nosy or getting involved with someone that you really shouldn't be. How about you see a man manhandling a woman? Who's seen that? At the mall? Yeah, I have. What do you do? What would you do? I hope you'll do this. Should you confront the man? Maybe. How about this? How about ask the woman? Are you okay? Right? Confronting the man, you may end up with a fight, right? You may turn that. But if you ask the woman, are you okay? That's some pretty important information, right? And then hopefully, maybe you'll get involved in that, right? How about if you have or see someone who's kind of passed out drunk, being carted off by somebody else? What would you do then? And that's actually happened to me. I was the one, when I was most of your ages, who, not being the drinker, used to bring home my friends, male and female, and sort of prop them up on the door and ding-dong ditch. Because I didn't want to explain to the father of one of my female friends why I'm bringing home his daughter passed out drunk. That's not a conversation I wanted to have at that age. But I would make sure that she got home to the front door, and I would be a little bit away and wait till the door opened and then run as fast as I could back to my car and sparked far away. Okay? So I hope you'll be that person, right? Let's not miss an opportunity to connect. And you know, it can be as simple as, I can tell you I see it,
I have students from time to time. I can tell they're not themselves. And you know, you're all here and you have an orbit. Moore Park's a little different because why? Because we don't live here too, right? So a lot of college experiences, students live on campus and you have more of a connection. But we still should have a connection here. If you see one of your classmates, if you see somebody, why not ask them, hey, how are you? You don't seem yourself. And you know, at the beginning of our talk, I think one of the most important things was brought up is that we have services here on campus. We have services, and I can tell you from firsthand experience, they're tremendous. Our health center, the counselors, our nurses, they are truly professionals, and they're beyond professionals. They're specialists in your population. And you know, doing things alone is good, but not everything alone. There's a lot of things, help is necessary. And so if you see someone who needs help, don't miss that opportunity. Be interested, not nosy. You don't have to know why they need help to help them, right? You can still help them. And so, you know, the great Buddha, right? Have compassion for all beings, rich and poor alike. And not just, this doesn't mean, right, rich in wealth, right? This means rich in happiness, rich in stability, rich in balance, or poor in happiness and poor in stability. And so each has their sufferings. So, you know, I hope that that in your path in life, you will be a bystander, whether you like it or not. Things will unfold in front of you, and you have the ability to make it better. Just because you don't have specialized skill, just because you don't feel like a hero, doesn't matter. Small things, what you'll find, my experience is, what matters most in life are the small things, the small connections, the things that you maybe don't really think are gonna matter. Those things in the end add up to a lot. And so I want to leave you with the words of Einstein. The world will not be destroyed by those who do evil, but by those who watch them and do nothing. So thanks for staying a little late. Ladies, any last words before we break? So you know, I hope it's been fun. I learned some stuff, maybe some things I didn't want to learn, but I learned some things. Are there any questions before you're released? Okay, well, it's been fun, and I hope your life has been enriched. I know mine has.
Thank you.
Good job.